Anna of Russia, Anna Ioannovna, also spelled Anna Ivanovna and sometimes anglicized as Anne, was regent of the Duchy of Kurland from 1711 until 1730 and then ruled as Empress of Russia from 1730 to 1740. Anna was born in Moscow as the daughter of Tsar Ivan V by his wife Praskovya Saltykova. Ivan V was co-ruler of Russia along with his younger half-brother Peter the Great, but he was mentally disabled and incapable of administering the country, and Peter effectively ruled alone. Ivan V died in February 1696, when Anna was only 3 years old, and her half-uncle became the sole ruler of Russia. Although Anna was the fourth child of her parents, she had only one surviving elder sister, Catherine, and one younger sister, Praskovya. The three girls were raised in a disciplined and austere manner by their widowed mother, a stern lady of sterling character. Born into a family of relatively modest means, Praskovya Saltykova had been an exemplary wife to a mentally challenged man, and expected her daughters to live up to her own high standards of morality and virtue. Anna grew up within a milieu which cherished womanly virtue and domesticity above all else, and placed strong emphasis on thrift, charity and religious observances. Her education consisted of French, German, religious texts and folklore, leavened with some music and dancing. As she grew older, she developed into an obstinate girl, with a mean streak, earning her the nickname of Anna the Terrible. Anna was famed for her big cheek, which, as shown in her portraits, says Thomas Carlyle, was comparable to a Westphalian ham. In time, her uncle Peter the Great ordered the family to move from Moscow to St. Petersburg. This meant a change of not just location but also society, and this had a significant effect on Anna. She greatly enjoyed the splendor of court and the lavishness of high society, which was very different from the austerity preferred by her mother. In 1710, Peter the Great arranged for the 17-year-old Anna to marry Frederick William, Duke of Kurland, who was the same age as her daughter. Wedding was held on a grand scale, as per her own inclinations, and her uncle gave her a fabulous dowry of 200,000 rubles. At the feast which followed the wedding, two dwarfs performed a parody by jumping out of enormous pies and dancing on the tables. The newly wedded couple spent several weeks in Russia before proceeding to Kurland. Only 20 miles out of St. Petersburg, on the road to Kurland, Duke Frederick died. The cause of death was uncertain. It has been attributed variously to a chill or to the effects of alcohol. After her husband died, Anna proceeded to Yalgava, the capital of Kurland, and ruled that province for almost 20 years, from 1711 to 1730. During this period, the Russian resident, Peter Bestuzhev, was her advisor. She never remarried after the death of her husband, but her enemies said she conducted a love affair with Ernst Johann von Baron, a prominent courtier, for many years. In 1730, Tsar Peter II died childless at a young age. His death rendered extinct the male line of the Romanov dynasty, which had ruled Russia for over a century, since 1613. There were five possible candidates for the throne, the three surviving daughters of Ivan V, namely Catherine, Anna herself and Praskovya, and the two surviving daughters of Peter the Great, namely Anna and Elizabeth. Ivan V had been the older brother of Peter the Great and co-ruler with him, and by that reckoning, his daughters may be considered to have the prior claim. However, if seen from the perspective that the successor should be the nearest kin of the most recent monarch, then the daughters of Peter the Great were nearer to the throne, because they were the aunts of the recently deceased Tsar Peter II. The dilemma was made greater because the daughters of Peter the Great had been born out of wedlock, and had been legitimized later by him, after he formally married their mother Catherine I, who had previously been a Mijin in his household. On the other hand, Praskovya Saltykova, the wife of Ivan V, had been a nobleman's daughter and a devoted wife and mother. Moreover, she had been a lady greatly respected for her many virtues, not least her chastity. Finally, the Russian Supreme Privy Council led by Prince Dmitry Golitsyn selected Anna, the second daughter of Ivan V, to be the new Empress of Russia. She was selected in preference to her elder sister Catherine, even though Catherine was at that time resident in Russia whereas Anna was not. There were some reasons for this. Anna was a childless widow and there was no immediate danger of an unknown foreigner wielding power in Russia. She also had some experience of government, because she had been administering her late husband's Duchy of Kurland for almost 2 decades. Catherine, on the other hand, was married to the Duke of Mecklenburg-Schwerin. She was now separated from him and living in Russia, which was in itself disgraceful, and whether her husband was present or absent, his existence could raise problems at her very coronation. His intervention in government affairs at some later point could hardly be prevented, especially since Catherine had a daughter by him. In that event, Since he was ruling prince of ancient lineage with years of experience, he would not be as amenable to the council's advice as a Russian princess. Also, the fact that Catherine had a daughter already would provide a certainty of succession which the nobles perhaps preferred not to have. The Supreme Privy Council preferred the childless and widowed Duchess of Courland. They hoped that she would feel indebted to the nobles and remain a figurehead at best, and malleable at worst. To make sure of that, the council convinced Anna to sign a declaration of conditions to her accession, modeled after a Swedish precedent, which stated that Anna was to govern according to their council and was not permitted to declare war, call for peace, impose new taxes or spend the revenue of the state without their consent. She could not punish nobility without trial, could not make grants off estates or villages, could not appoint high officials, and could not promote anyone, whether foreign or Russian, to court offices without the consent of the council. The deliberations of the council were held even as Peter II lay dying of smallpox during the winter of 1729-30. The document of conditions was presented to Anna in January, and she signed the same on January 18, 1730, which was just around the time of his death. The ceremony of endorsement was held at her capital, Jelgava in Courland, and she then proceeded to the Russian capital. On February 20, 1730, shortly after her arrival, Empress Anna exercised her prerogative to do away with her predecessor's Privy Council and dissolve that body. The Supreme Privy Council, which had stipulated those onerous conditions, had been composed largely of the families of the Princess Dolgoruki and Galitzin. Within a matter of days, another faction Rossiyte court which was opposed to the domination of these two families. On March 7, 1730, a group of people belonging to this faction arrived at the palace and petitioned the empress to repudiate the conditions and assume the autocracy of her predecessors. Among those who urged Anna to do so was her elder sister Catherine. Anna duly repudiated the document of conditions, and for good measure sent some of the framers of the document to the scaffold, and many others to Siberia. She then assumed autocratic powers and ruled as an absolute monarch, in the same fashion as her predecessors. On the night that Anna tore up the conditions, an aurora borealis appeared in the sky, making the horizon appear in all blood in the words of one contemporary, which was widely taken to be a dark omen of what Anna's reign would be like. Strong-willed and eccentric, Anna was known for her cruelty and vulgar sense of humor. She forced Prince to become her court jester and had him married off to her unattractive Kalmuk maid. To celebrate the wedding, the Empress had an ice palace measuring 33 feet high and 80 feet long built together with icy beds, steps, chairs, windows and even logs of ice in a fireplace of ice. Prince Galitzin and his bride were placed in a cage atop an elephant and paraded through the streets to this structure, to spend their wedding night in the ice palace, despite it being an extremely cold night in the dead of winter. The Empress Anna told the couple to make love and keep their bodies close if they did not wish to freeze to death. Eventually, the couple survived when Themid traded a pearl necklace for a sheepskin coat from one of the guards. An enthusiastic hunter, Anna always kept a rifle by her window so she could blast away at birds at all hours of the day whenever she felt the urge to hunt. Anna continued lavish architectural advances in St. Petersburg. She completed a waterway that began construction under Peter the Great and called for seafaring ships to accompany this new canal and continue naval expansion. Anna's lover Ernst Johann von Baron was a Baltic German, and due to his influence Baltic Germans are favored with government offices, leading to the resentment of the ethnic Russian nobility, though the American historian Walter Moss cautioned that popular image of the Byron of Sheena as one of total Baltic German domination of Russia is exaggerated. Anna founded the Cadet Corps in 1731, 1 year after coming to the throne. The Cadet Corps was a group of young boys starting at the age of 8 being trained for the military. There was a very rigorous training program, and this also included all the schooling that was necessary for someone to be in an important position in the military. As time went on though, the program was later improved by other emperors and empresses, such as Catherine the Great. They began to include the arts and sciences into their schooling, rather than just the knowledge that is considered necessary for only a career in the military. Started by Peter the Great, Anna continued to fund the Russian Academy of Science. The point of this school was to further the sciences in Russia and to help bring the country that was so far behind up to where the Western countries were. Some of the sciences that were taught were mathematics, astronomy, and botany. The Academy of Science was also responsible for a lot of the expeditions, specifically to the Bering Sea. The Bering Sea expedition is one of the more famous ones that was done by the Academy of Science. While they were trying to find out if America and Asia had been at one point connected, they also studied Siberia and its people, These studies were used long after they returned from Siberia. But there were also some troubles for the scientists. Oftentimes the government and the church would meddle in their funding and their experiments, changing the data to how they wanted to see it. This school of science was very small, never exceeding a population of 12 students in the university and barely over 100 in the secondary school. But still it was a huge step forward for education in Russia. Many of the teachers and professors were imported from Germany, bringing more of a Western feeling to what the students were learning. Some of the students to learn from these German professors later became advisors or teachers to some of the future leaders, such as Catherine the Great's tutor, Edna Jurov. During Anna's reign, the Academy of Science began to include the arts into their program, as there was no school for the arts yet, and Anna was a firm supporter of the arts. Theater, architecture, engraving, and journalism were all added to the curriculum. During this time, the foundations of what is now the world-famous Russian ballet was laid down as well. There have been many rumors since the time of Anna's reign that Baron had a large impact on this office, but truly it was run by the senator A.I. Ushakov. This office was resurrected during Anna's reign to punish those for political crimes mostly, but sometimes they would take cases that were not as political. The punishments that came from the crimes that were committed were often very painful and disgusting. For example, some people that had supposedly been plotting against the government had their noses slit, as well as being beaten with a knout. Russian authorities listed a total of around 20,000 Russians, including some of the highest native nobility, who fell victim to Baron and Anna's police. Anna gave many privileges to those that were considered the nobility. In 1730 she made sure that the law of Peter the Great that outlawed states from being subdivided, the primogeniture law, was repealed. Starting in 1731, landlords were made responsible for their serfs' taxes, which tightened further their economic bondage. In 1736, when the age of service changed to 20 with a 25-year service time, Anna and her government also determined that if the family had more than one son, one could stay behind so that he could work the estate. Westernization continued after Peter the Great's reign in areas of prominent Western culture such as the Academy of Science, cadet corps education, and imperial culture, including theater and opera. Although not at the fast-paced speed of westernization under her uncle Peter's reign, it is evident that a culture of the expansion of knowledge continued during Anna's rule and affected mostly the nobility. It is argued that this success in westernization is due to the efforts of the German court nobility. The foreigners' impacts are viewed both positively and negatively. Anna's reign is different from that of other imperial Russian rulers in one respect. Her court was almost entirely made up of foreigners, the majority of whom were A-German. Some observers have argued that historians isolate her rule from Russian history due to their long-term prejudice towards Germans, towards whom Anna seems to have had a soft corner. There is a lot of mention of Germans throughout the reign of Anna. For example, she often gave them ruling positions in her cabinet and other important decision-making positions. This was because she had very little trust in the Russians. It was because of this strong German influence in government that many Russians came to resent them. During Anna's reign, Russia became involved in two major conflicts, the War of the Polish Succession and another Turkish war. In the former, Russia worked with Austria to support Augustus II's son Augustus against the candidacy of Stanislaw Leszczynski, who was dependent on the French and amiable with Sweden and Ottoman. Russia's involvement with the conflict was quickly over, however, and the Russo-Turkish War was much more important. In 1732, Nader Shah had forced Russia to return the lands in northern mainland Persia that had been taken during Peter the Great's Russo-Persian War. The Treaty of Rasht furthermore permitted an alliance against the Ottoman Empire, the common enemy, and, in any case, the provinces of Shirvan, Gilan, and Mazandaran had been a net drain on the imperial treasury for the entirety of their occupation. 3 years later, in 1735, conforming to the Treaty of Ganja, the remainder of the territories taken more than a decade earlier from Persia in the North Caucasus and South Caucasus were returned as well. The war against the Turks took 4.5 years, 100,000 men, and millions of rubles. Its burdens caused great stress on the people of Russia, and it only gained Russia the city of Azov and its environs. Its effects, however, were greater than they first appeared. Ostermann's policy of southern expansion prevailed over the 1711 Peace of Pruth signed by Peter the Great. Munich had given Russia its first campaign against Turkey that had not ended in crushing disaster and dissipated the illusion of Ottoman invincibility. He had further shown that Russia's grenadiers and hussar school defeat twice their number of janissaries and spahi. The Tatar hordes of the Crimea had been exterminated, and Russia's signal and unexpected successes greatly increased its prestige within Europe. The Russians also established a protectorate over the Khan of the Kyrgyz, sending officers to assist his short-lived conquest of Kiev. Two Chinese embassies to Anna's court, first at Moscow in 1731, then at St. Petersburg the following year, were the only ones China dispatched to Europe through the late 19th century. These embassies were unique also in that they represented the only occasions where officials of the Chinese Empire kowtowed before a foreign ruler. After being widowed just weeks following her wedding, Anna never remarried. As Empress of Russia, she enjoyed the power she held over all men and may have thought that marriage would undermine her power and position. Nevertheless, Anna's reign is often referred to as the Age of Biron, after her German lover Ernst Johann Biron. Historians aver that Biron not only had a strong influence on Anna's domestic and foreign policies, but also that at times he wielded power solely without reference to the Empress. Anna was attracted to Biron's personal charm and he proved to be a good companion to her, but his name became synonymous with cruelty and terror. In public perception, these negative qualities became the hallmark of Anna's reign. As her health declined, Anna declared her grandnephew, Ivan VI, as her successor and appointed Biron as regent. This was an attempt to secure the line of her father, Ivan V, and exclude the descendants of Peter the Great from inheriting the throne. It was recorded that she had an ulcer on her kidneys, and she continued having attacks of gout. As her condition worsened, her health began to fail. Anna died on October 17, 1740 at the age of 47 from a terrible kidney stone that made for a slow and painful death. The Tsaritsa's final words focused on Biron. Ivan VI was only a two-month-old baby at the time, and his mother, Anna Leopoldovna, was detested for her German counselors and relations. As a consequence, shortly after Anna's death, Elizabeth Petrovna, legitimized daughter of Peter the Great, managed to gain the favor of the populace, locked Ivan VI in a dungeon, and exiled his mother. Anna was buried 3 months later on January 15, 1741, leaving behind uncertainty for the future of Russia. In the West, Anna's reign was traditionally viewed as a continuation of the transition from the old Muscovy ways to the European court envisioned by Peter the Great. Her government, on the whole, was prudent, beneficial and even glorious, but it was undoubtedly severe and became at last universally unpopular. Within Russia, Anna's reign is often referred to as a dark era. The issue with her reign derives from her personality flaws. Even considering the need of Russian rulers to avoid displays of weakness, Anna's rule involved questionable actions towards her subjects. She was known to enjoy hunting animals from the palace windows and, on more than a few occasions, humiliated individuals with disabilities. There were continued issues with serfdom, peasant and lower class slavery, taxation, dishonesty, and rule through constant fear. Her empire was described by Lafour, the Saxon minister, as being comparable to a storm-threatened ship, manned by a pilot and crew who are all drunk or asleep. With no considerable future, Anna's war with Turkey, economic issues, and conspiracy revolving around her accession all bring to light an ominous glow of the Empress' reign. She restored the court in St. Petersburg and brought Russia's political atmosphere back to where Peter the Great had intended, and its grandeur was almost unmatched in Europe or Asia. But such lavish court life was overshadowed by the thousands of men slaughtered in war. It is undeniable she had a vast impact in science and culture, but it came with a price. The positive aspects of Anna's reign are typically ignored, though it is important to note that she had no more influence on domestic and foreign relations and policies than any other 18th century ruler. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.